was like,
good morning.
Good morning. I am Amanda Thode with AdvancedNet. I am updating my name right now.
Hey, I am Duchess Harris.
Okay. You look great. You sound great.
All right, let's find a background. Let's see. I think my house is okay. Is my house okay?
I think so, yeah. And the puppy.
Dog out of it. I can't keep my dog out of it. I'll do my professional background. I might just do my professional background and be on the safe side.
That looks good. Do you want me to send you the NCOBPS one?
Yeah. Okay.
Sure. I will send
I don't want to be left mind. Out. I want to be part of things. I want to have what Tiffany has.
I will do that. 1 second. No one else has joined yet. There you go. I just emailed it to you.
All right. So where are you located?
I'm located in Dallas, Texas.
Okay.
Where are you located?
Well, I was about to say, something tells me that that's warmer than where I am. I am in Minneapolis, where it is a balmy 14 degrees.
Yeah, it's like 50 here today, so it's a little warmer.
Yeah, nothing like 14 to make you ask yourself what spring means.
I know. I lived in Chicago for 7 years. And like when it was cold in January, you understand it's supposed to be cold in January. When it's cold in like April, you know, in May, you're like, okay, this is when it gets really tough, you know. So.
Okay. So let's see. Now, how do I put these in Zoom again? I forget.
So next to the stop video, there's the little up arrow, you know, and so you click on that and you go choose virtual background, mm-hmm. and then there's a plus. And so when you click on plus, you can add an image or video, and then you
Where's
just select
the plus?
Them.
Oh, I see over here.
Yeah.
Oh, supercalifragilistic. Look at me. Oh my God. I'm a cool kid. I like fitting in. All right. Well, I'm going to mute myself so I'll stop talking to you.
Okay, that sounds good. Hello, are you one of the presenters for this session? Your name didn't look familiar, but I just wanted to let you in case, but.
Thank you.
So where's the rub? I don't have room for. I see what you're saying on the island of the kitchen.
Hello, my name is Amanda Thode. I am with AdvanceNet, and I will be your tech support for this session. So I'd love to do a sound check and visual check for everyone that just joined. So if you could just say something.
Hi, introduce yourself. Hi, this is HQ. Good morning, everyone.
Great. Good morning. And Valeria, can I get a, are you speaking at the session? If so, can I get a sound check and a visual check?
Good morning. So do I need to find this?
Do you want me to send it to you? I can send it
to you. Yes. Thank you, Amanda.
Yeah. I'm sorry. I'm Amanda with the answer. So, and do you know, is Gilda Forbang or Hoda Zaki or Jasmine? Oh, never mind. I know Jasmine. Are any of those people presenters that should be let in to the session? I'm just trying to make sure. Do you know? Okay.
I don't know. Okay. I don't think so.
Okay. All right. I will send you the virtual background. Just give me 1 second.
Okay. You have my email, vsc@purdue.edu.
1 second. I believe I do. Yes, I do.
Okay.
Perfect. Amanda, do I have to have the background?
Or you do not have.
Okay.
Yes,
great.
Your background.
I would like to use this.
Yes.
I like yours much better than my father's loft area.
Hey, good morning, everyone.
Morning. Hey, Duchess, what in the world? Your book is being banned? What in the world?
You know,
I know, right?
I'm poorly behaved.
No, you're brilliant, and apparently that's not acceptable. What in the world? No,
it's just they just want to hold me back.
Exactly, won't let you be great. I don't know what's going on out here. That is crazy, but they don't know that it has the opposite effect.
Exactly.
Unintended consequences.
Right. Exactly. I hope lots and lots and lots and lots of people go out and get away with it.
Exactly. Exactly. It's ridiculous. So anyway, good morning, everybody. All right, I'm looking for it, Amanda, when it comes. So.
It should be on its way. It shows that it's sent.
All right, very good.
Good morning.
Good morning. Hi, Tony. It's been like, what, 15 years? I think the last time we saw each other was probably at the APSA meeting. Well, when probably. We were both doing the ethnic, the book award for. Dissertation award. Good to see
dissertation
you.
Went for REP or something?
Yeah, that's exactly it. It was like section. 2007 or something. It was a long time ago.
Been a while. Hi, Valeria. Hi, Duchess.
Hello. Hey. I don't know if it's been 15 years, but it's been a minute, Tony.
Yeah. I see you on Facebook every day. And LinkedIn and Twitter.
I feel like I see Tony often. And I dropped out of Facebook on January 1st. I thought I would be back by now. It was just, boy, it was sucking at my life.
Oh, I want to do that.
I'm going to go get a cup of coffee. I'll be right back.
I can't stand Facebook.
It motivates my behavior in certain kinds of ways. I want to come back on, but then I got roped into the algorithm for whatever, for those reels. And boy, next thing I know, I was spending hours just flipping through rocks. It was crazy.
Can we organize ourselves a little bit?
Yeah, I'm in the background.
Duchess and Valeria and HQ went for coffee. Jen and I are going to tag team back and forth. We took the bios that you sent us and we will essentially read those and try to look like we're not reading just to introduce you so you don't have to spend time introducing yourselves. And because of the way we framed the request, we wanted to focus your bio on the work of this plenary rather than your general professional background. So Duchess, thank you. You did a nice job, you know, really framing your
how long do we have bio. To speak?
I did not do a nice
job. You did not, but it's okay. We forgive you.
Make it
up.
Now, Tony.
Duchess, we don't have it set up that way. What we're going to do is we're going to ask two questions. I'm going to ask a question and kind of coordinate a dialogue, a multi-log. And then Jen has a second question. Let me see, I can tell you what those questions are. The first one, the one I'm going to ask, how would you characterize where we are in history when we consider how your scholarship advances the Black struggle and protects rights for Black people? And then secondly, how is your work shaped by the current state of Black America in the broader political context of resurgent white supremacy and resistance to it? So Valeria-
well, easy stuff like that.
Yeah, well-
I got answers.
Yeah. So Valeria, all three of you, Valeria, Duchess, and HQ, we're going to hit all three of you with that question. You can kind of dialogue among yourselves. You can interrupt each other gently, not New York style, more like Minneapolis style. and then the second question, which Jen will raise, is what are the stakes of public intellectualism right now? How should we respond? How do you consider the risks and opportunities of the work that you do given the stage of your career? Do you worry about potential consequences? And for that, Hakeem, Jen, and HQ will be on tap for that. And then Duchess, you and I can chime in if we have something important to say. But all we wanted to divide it up. So we weren't asking all of you to talk about both questions.
Okay.
But it's really free form. HQ, are you back?
Yes, I'm back, Tony. Could you
the first
mentioned
question?
Yeah.
That's okay. The first question we're going to hit you with, and we're going to direct this at you, Valeria and Duchess, is, how would you characterize where we are in history when we consider how your scholarship advances the Black struggle and protects rights for Black people? And secondly, how is your work shaped by the current state of Black America in the broader political context of resurgent white supremacy and Black resistance? And then the second question, which I think you caught the tail end of, what are the stakes of public intellectualism right now? Do you worry about potential consequences? What are the risks and opportunities? And again, the three of you and Hakeem will be asked to respond to that. So there, we don't have a set time, you know, like 5 minutes for you, 5 minutes for you. We wanna pose the question and then let the three or four of you respond as you think best to those questions. Are we good?
Yeah,
Tony, yes, HQ.
I'm sorry. I think when in preparation for this, I think I used a very scaled down questions that initially got circulated. So do you mind putting the questions you just posed in the chat so I can cut and paste and because I want to make sure I honor.
I'll do that right now. I'm not sure if the chat is going to be open to the public.
Oh, okay, that's fine.
Probably, no, I'll put it in now and then. Well, I don't know. I guess I can't really delete it from the chat, can I?
No, you can't. You could direct message it.
Let me do that. Yeah.
Nice. I'm glad you
that. Thank you. Sorry about that.
I mean,
that's okay.
Yeah, that makes sense. I'm sorry. I was trying to get the volume down so you could call your sister. I was like, why aren't you calling your sister?
What's happening? Okay.
We can hear. Yeah. We can
mute. Okay. But I think, Tony, whatever is in the chat before people join, they can't see. That's what
HQ, I just direct message you the first question, and here comes the second one. I will ask the first question and kind of coordinate the multi-log, and Jen will do the second one.
Got it.
Does anybody else want those questions? Okay, good.
Sure, that'd be helpful.
Hakeem, yeah. Good morning. Can't hear a word you're saying.
I was on mute.
There you are. Just want to reprise what I just told the others. Jen Jackson and I will kind of be, you know, crossing guards, not traffic cops, crossing guards for this discussion. And we're going to begin by introducing each of you with the short paragraph that you sent us. HQ, did you write a few words for us?
I did. I thought I sent it to Tiffany.
I didn't get it.
That was the less than 100 words, right?
Yes. Let me go back to Hakeem, though. Hakeem, we have yours, so we'll start. Jen and I will read those to introduce you, so that you don't have to introduce.
You probably need to send it to Tony. Oh, she probably needs to send it. She said she sent it to Tiffany. She needs to send it to Tony and.
Send it to me and Jen.
Okay.
So Hakeem, we're going to start off by reading those just to introduce you, so that you don't have to do that yourself, and then we're going to organize the discussion around two questions. The first of those having to do with kind of contextualizing and locating yourself in history. I'll read that in a second. And the second is to talk about the stakes of public intellectualism, risk and reward opportunities, potential consequences, and so on. So if you'd like, I can put those in a direct chat to you, Hakeem. You want to do it that way?
Sure.
So you can see those. I will ask the first question and kind of coordinate that part of the discussion. And then Jen Jackson will pose the second question and coordinate that part. And as I told everyone else, we don't have a set time, how long you can speak. We just ask you to be judicious and give everyone a chance to contribute. And once we've gone through the people that we have designated, for instance, for the first one, the first question, we want to focus on Duchess Valeria and HQ. And then, of course, Hakeem, if you have something to add to that, you can certainly chime in as well. For the second question, we're going to kind of direct it to you, Hakeem, and to Jen and HQ. But again, Duchess and Valeria, you know, feel free to come in on that as you see fit.
Very good. Thank you all.
Tony, I just forwarded the email I sent to Tiffany to you. And I can put it in the chat as well. Would you like me to put it in the chat?
Yeah, you can if you like. I am going to add it to the Google Doc that we've been using to plan all this. Jen will be reading that to introduce you.
Jen's not here yet. I will try to send her the link again, but do we want to start without her? Or do we want to wait until...
Well, we still have another minute and a half, so if you could
send her that link.
But I would like to start on time, and she can come in.
Tony, can you send me that question privately that you sent out?
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
the first question about contextualizing your work. And then I'll send you the second one as well, which is on risk and reward and consequences. Okay, that should be in the chat for you, Duchess. I gave my teenage son your Black Lives Matter book, and I think it overwhelmed him.
Oh, wow. That is very kind. And that is a typical response. So I appreciate that, though.
Yeah. Well, he's got to know. Okay. We're going to get started. Amanda, Tiffany's calling me. Hold on one second. Hello, Tiffany. You can't get in? I'll tell Amanda. Amanda? Amanda?
Yep.
Uh-huh. Tiffany just called me, said she can't get into the site.
I will send her the link as well.
There are also a bunch of people in the waiting room, I think.
Yes, I was trying to wait to see if we could get Ms. Jackson, Dr. Jackson in. So
you can go ahead and let people in. If you can do it all at once, that'd be great.
Okay. And they wanted to play the book celebration video first. So Tony, is it okay? I'm gonna play that and then you'll kick it off, yes?
Well, I suppose we'll do whatever President Willoughby Herard tells us to do.
Okay, so one second, let me just.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Presidential Plenary. I am Tony Affigne from Providence College, and I am going to turn it over briefly to President Willoughby Herard.
Good morning, everyone. I'm so glad to be here today, and I hope that you were as moved as I was by that wonderful song by Amethyst Kaya and just being able to remember everything about what it means to be a scholar of Black politics. This titled panel of presidential plenary is called I Teach, Research, Think, and Write What I Like. Silence is not an option. In 1969 in South Africa, Steve Biko famously began to publish essays in the South African Student Organization newspaper. In the collection of anti-colonial essays published as I Write What I Like in the UCLA journal Ufahamu in 1978, and also as a book, Biko picked up on the thread raised over centuries of Black political thought. Biko echoed Zora Neale Hurston's disgusted rebuttal against, quote, what white publishers won't print, published in the Negro Digest in 1950. By 1972, Biko's words were banned. By 1977, he was assassinated. In this plenary, we invite members of our scholarly community to reflect together on the conditions that find our teaching, research, writing, and thinking under attack. Instead of being legible as some of the most insightful social scientific-based problem solvers of this generation, vicious campaigns are being lodged against the policy solutions and findings they are seeking to share. In this plenary, we intend to celebrate their courage, affirm that they must continue to think, research, write, and teach what they like, and to affirm that we will defend them. The research of the members of this panel is part of making a livable future. And I will hand the panel back over to our moderators, Dr. Jenn Jackson of Syracuse University and Dr. Tony Affigne of Providence College. Thank you everyone for being here.
Thank you, President Willoughby Herard. Dr. Jackson and I will tag team all of you, moderating the discussion among our panelists. I want to begin by contextualizing a little bit of what President Willoughby Herard just said. As you may know, when political science was founded as a scholarly discipline in 1880 by a group of white men, Rutherford B. Hayes was the president. Hayes, you might recall, ended Reconstruction in the South. We were just one generation from the conquest of northern Mexico. The Chinese Exclusion Act would be approved 2 years later. Geronimo would be captured in 1886. The massacre at Wounded Knee would occur in 1890. And of course, the end of Reconstruction meant the beginning of the long period of Jim Crow. But those white racist political scientists, and I say racist advisedly, they were all supporters of the Ku Klux Klan and advocates of the Southern myth, had no interest in the politics of Black people. They had no interest in the politics of any people of color. And it would be more than 50 years before the first political science book treatment of the politics of Black Americans would appear. This panel, which is an opportunity for all of us in NCOBPS to reflect on the importance and the power of the work that we do, but also the risk and the consequences of the work that we do. We're here to celebrate the courage and the contributions of our panelists, and we are here to talk about and to understand and reflect on how we can continue to mobilize the power of the community going forward, using our scholarship and our advocacy and our public scholarship as weapons and tools in the continuing struggle for Black freedom. I'm gonna turn it over to Dr. Jackson for her introductory comments, and then we will briefly introduce each of the panelists and pose some thought questions for them, and then allow a free-form discussion among our panelists. Dr. Jackson.
Thanks so much, Dr. Affigne. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here with us today. I'm not gonna repeat what has already been said, but I do think I wanna have a unique contribution in that I wanna talk today specifically about the ways that several people in the room and a lot of us have witnessed in the past at least 2 to 5 years that scholars of color have been targeted on social media by various outlets and platforms for public ire and attacks and harassment. So in this conversation today, I really want us to be thinking about what that looks like going forward and what the risks are and implications are for our discipline and for young folks who are coming up, scholars of tomorrow, folks who are still assistant professors and looking to be tenured in the discipline. So absolutely, let's move into introductions for the panel. We will read them off when I have folks introduce themselves. Dr. Affigne.
We're going to introduce our panelists with some comments that we asked them to send to us about where their work fits into the current context. The first of those is Duchess Harris. And Duchess tells us that a Texas lawmaker running for higher office recently announced an investigation of school districts' books on race and sexuality. And that lawmaker targeted a 16-page list of 850 titles. Four of those titles were written by Duchess Harris. Dr. Harris is a McAllister College professor who has written 5 academic books, and she is also the proud curator of the Duchess Harris Collection of 120 books written for 4th to 12th graders. 2 of Dr. Harris's books for 4th to 12th graders are about Black Lives Matter. These books were denounced by Larry Elder on Fox News.
So moving to Dr. Valeria Sinclair-Chapman, in your introduction you shared with us, you let us know that you're a professor of political science at Purdue University in West Lafayette, Indiana. Dr. Sinclair-Chapman's work is deeply concerned with the politics of marginalized groups and a particular focus on the effects of diversity on political institutions and participation from the halls of Congress to the streets of protests. Dr. Sinclair-Chapman has served on the councils of NCOBPS, APSA, WPSA, and MPSA, among many other service contributions to the discipline. She's also an associate editor for the American Political Science Review, co-director for the Institute of Civically Engaged Research, and the co-chair of last year's APSA annual meeting in Seattle. Dr. Sinclair-Chapman is a past co-president of APSA's REP section and oversaw the debate and initial vote to establish the JREP journal. The section's online journal of race, ethnicity, and politics, an award-winning teacher and a researcher. Valeria is also an advocate for greater diversity in the discipline from undergrads to graduate study to tenure track to the ranks of tenured faculty across the country and around the world.
Thank you. Hakeem Jefferson began speaking to public audiences about race and justice when he was just 13 years old. 20 years later, as a professor and public-facing scholar, Dr. Jefferson writes frequently for 538 about these topics and has authored several op-eds. He has co-led open letter campaigns in support of democracy-enhancing legislation, and he comments regularly in news stories about issues related to Black politics. But this work has not been without consequence. Dr. Jefferson regularly receives hate mail, is listed on the professor watch list. He has been the focus of segments in right-wing media, and last year had ads taken out about him by the Horowitz Freedom Center, a right-wing hate group.
So moving next to Dr. Affigne. Before becoming a teacher, researcher, and author, Dr. Affigne was a community organizer, helping mobilize neighborhood power in Black and Latinx communities, challenging slumlords, the police, and corrupt local politicians. In some ways, his career in political science has followed a similar path, challenging racial exclusion in the profession, white supremacy in academic theory and practice, and the intellectual corruption of scholarship divorced from lived realities. He was a principal founder of APSA section REP, Race, Ethnicity, and Politics, co-founded the Latino Caucus in Political Science, and was founding director of the Black Studies in Providence College. So I'm supposed to actually have this alternate to Dr. Affigne, but I'll go ahead and give my own introduction since I didn't actually submit it on time. I'm Jenn Jackson, third year tenure track professor at Syracuse University in the Department of Political Science. What I bring to this conversation is actually very similar to Dr. Jefferson. In the years since I've graduated and also before graduating from UChicago in 2019, I was a writer of public platforms like Washington Post, Ebony, Teen Vogue, and such. In doing that work, I've become the target of the professor watch list and campus reform. And in fall of 2021, there was a national campaign, a right-wing campaign to try and get me removed from my post here at Syracuse University after several tweets that I sent about 9/11. So that resulted in several death threats, quite a few death threats. Overall kind of heightened security on campus and as well in my neighborhood community and for my children and family. So it's a very personal conversation for me that I bring to this conversation today.
Thank you, Dr. Jackson. As a target of another target of David Horowitz's campaign against critical scholarship and teaching since 2006, Professor H.L.T. Quan, HQ, has spoken publicly about the current attacks on critical scholarship, especially the censoring of critical Black scholarship, as fundamentally anti-intellectual and anti-democratic. Dr. Quan urges the public, especially scholars, to resist this rising authoritarianism as they work within their communities to push back against legislative campaigns of censorship. So as you can see, the panelists who will be speaking today all come to you as accomplished scholars. They all come to you as targets of criticism and in some cases personal attacks because of that scholarship. What we'd like to do then is begin the discussion by asking Dr. Sinclair-Chapman, Dr. Harris, and Dr. Quan to consider how their work is situated in history. How would you characterize when we consider how your scholarship advances the Black struggle, how would you characterize where we are and where you are in history? And in particular, how is your work shaped by the current state of Black America in the broader context of resurgent white supremacy and Black resistance to it? Dr. Sinclair-Chapman, would you like to address that question?
Sure, thank you. Thank you. Tony and Jen, and by this esteemed panel, I am grateful to be a part of it. I just want to begin by making note of the fact that Sharon Wright Austin is not with us. She had a conflict. She's in Paris, sadly enough, right? She's in Paris for a course that she does on Blacks in Paris, where she takes students over every year. And so she's not with us, but I wanted to mention her as well, because Sharon was caught in the crosshairs of national politics and of politics in Florida simply because she wanted to testify about redistricting cases and about voting rights in the state of Florida. And her university was forbidden to do so. They were told that it was in conflict with the state, and her case had to go all the way to the Supreme Court to be decided. So our work is consequential and meaningful. I wanted to in an opening remark, and hopefully we can have some additional discussion, to say that in some ways, my work in political science, I've not been on a watch list. I'm gratified to be part of this group, but I have, I think, suffered consequences, both for the things that were important to me, for asking questions about the topics that were important to me, and for not perhaps moving at a pace or in the same kind of way that many in the discipline, particularly gatekeepers, wanted or determined that the discipline should move in. What counts as political science? These are the kinds of questions that I think have been important to me in my own work in a number of ways. One of the things that I would say as we kind of move from graduate study and on from undergrad to graduate study and throughout a career in the discipline is that we have to find our place. And sometimes the place where we are is not the place where we should be. And I hope that we can have some of that conversation. So with that, I'm gonna try to be brief. It's not my forte, but I will try to be brief and just to say that our careers span much more than our research, as I think has been indicated already. But one of the things that I had to write about and that I'm gratified that I did was confronting loss on the tenure track Because sometimes the work that we do is not rewarded. In fact, we are told, particularly as Black women, that maybe we would be better suited. They don't quite say secretaries, perhaps, in the way that they used to. But maybe you're better suited to be doing something else. Maybe you'd really be just a better, not a researcher, anything but that. How are we to understand you when we see you in that light? And I have experienced that personally. And the numbers suggest that many of us will. I'm not wishing that upon any of us, but there are ways that the discipline has exerted its own power and authority and gatekeeping, particularly at the top echelons, to move people out. I'm hopeful of seeing so many of us doing great work. The video at the beginning, I hope that we can, that we'll see this on YouTube. That video is amazing with so much that has come out in the last year. And I know that many of you in this room now are producing work that we will continue to read and to see. That's important. So I wanted to at least address that. I also wanted to think about the work that I'm doing as an editor for the APSR, in that what we're trying to do is actually open up who do we see as scholars. There was a time, and many of us know this, that the APSR has a 96-95% rejection rate. And so, but there was a time when scholarship that many of us do was just rejected on site. So we knew this is not a place where I wanted to send my work. And while there are still struggles, I think, with being published in the journal, I think that we are at least taking on the work of creating pathways, gateways to publication, to really defining and redefining and transforming what political science means to itself. And I think that that is part of the work of journals. And I did that as well when I was a co-editor with Nadia on politics, groups, and identity. So I would certainly encourage you to send your papers in as well to the National Political Science Review as well. So I don't mean to talk about these other journals, but I just want to say that there's a work that we have, a responsibility that we have to change how the discipline sees itself in our own work and change the scope of what political science is and what political scientists do.
Valeria, can we circle back to you after we get some comments from Duchess and HQ? We'll be
Absolutely.
Back. Thank you so much. Dr. Harris?
All right, good morning, everyone. And, you know, I could have listened to Valeria forever, but I'm glad to be on this presidential panel for this plenary. And in terms of question one, how would you characterize where we are in history? I would draw upon the historian Peniel Johnson, who talks about, Peniel Joseph, my apologies, who talks about this moment being the third reconstruction. And I would draw upon the literary scholar Elizabeth Alexander, who's the head of the Mellon Foundation, who talks about this being the Trayvon generation. And so I think that we are in the crosshairs of the Trayvon generation and the third reconstruction. As far as the next question is, how does my work, how has it been shaped by the current state of Black America? My work that I have done really was impacted when Michael Brown was killed. And one of my experiences with that was it was right coming up on APSA 2014, I was gonna have to return to teaching after a sabbatical. And I was so deeply hurt by that moment. And so I ended up being inspired the following spring to co-author a book on Black Lives Matter, which was for high school students. It was the first time I had ventured to do writing that wouldn't be considered traditional scholarship. And I have to admit, because of my internalized notions of who pays attention to what, I didn't think that anyone would take note of a book written for high school students. And the truth of the matter was that work got more attention than something I published with Duke Press. And it got the kind of attention that Larry Elder, who had not even read it because it hadn't even gone to press yet, said that it should not be introduced in schools. And that was 2015. And then 6 years later is when the Texas legislature came out with the banned book list. And that book, along with some other books that I've written on policing and violence from the state, have been banned as well. And so part of it makes me wonder if people read our more dense, what might be considered esoteric scholarship, or if this work is just easier for them to access. But I think it's an important moment to be a scholar, and I'm glad to be on this panel, and I will pause here so others have a chance to speak.
Thank you very much, Duchess. Dr. Quan?
Good morning. Good morning. I want to thank Dr. Affigne and Dr. Jackson for organizing this panel, and President Willoughby Harrod for having the foresight to create a space like this. I'm obviously delighted and humble and honored to be part of this conversation. I want to point to the image behind me because I think it's apropos of our conversation. This is the South African student, Black, Chinese, Indian students at the University of Witwatersrand protesting in 1957. Against what would become a major pillar of 20th century apartheid education, the 1957 Separate University Education Bill, which later got wrapped into the 1959, I think, Education Bill, would consolidate all of these measures that became the kind of pillar of apartheid education in South Africa. And that odious law never really expired until the South African School Act of 1996, which means that literally until after the apartheid regime collapsed, did it get replaced. And I say that because like that, just I think I'm thinking this is a third reconstruction, except that I think of the first reconstruction as a white reconstruction. And so I think that we are living in a moment of white supremacy being ascendant and on the move. And I think it is very well connected and well financed, in some way much more well financed than previously. So I think we're living in a dangerous time. So I read this moment and current campaign of censorship, including the more than 114 legislative initiatives at the state and local level to deracinate American history and evict critical scholarship, especially critical Black scholarship, from the curricula. Is, as I said, authoritarian, anti-elitist, and anti-democratic. I had a book project. I've been planning and writing or doing research for 5 years. I ended up in the last 2 years engaged in what I call a historical detour, which I then took up the so-called revolutionary great and the making of American anti-democracy. So that I could draw attention, I could provide a sustained examination of white supremacy and anti-Black violence. I think we're living in a very dangerous time. And like all campaigns of censorship, this one is about fear and it is about power. The power to silence and instill fear, the power to keep the gates of imperial knowledge permanently closed, the power to violently abstract people and communities from history, and the power of the people, particularly people formations that are led by Black abolition feminists to fight back. I think people need to understand that some of these people that are behind this campaign are billionaires and millionaires, and some of them even give a date for when this sort of served up as a flash, and that was the date of George Floyd's death and the mobilization that came afterward. So also the power of the people's history to revise and transform. And as someone who has been a target of David Horowitz's campaign of red baiting for more than a decade, I urge us against underestimating the virulence campaign of censorship, especially this one. I think this one is about going directly after the people who have been responsible for essentially creating spaces for us to live. So what President Willoughby Harrod said earlier, livability. And these folks are very serious. They are more connected than they have been in previous campaign. They already won gubernatorial races that it dwarfed the success of previous campaign. And the David Horowitz, whatever Academic Freedom Center, are at it again. They are producing sort of a bill mill, and so they're producing model legislation for people to copy. This is their K-12 toolkit. They call ethical classroom or something like that. So I would say that we have a responsibility to fight against fascism, and we have an obligation to bring visibility to anti-Black violence, anti-Black racism, and white supremacy, the very thing that BLM and Movement for Black Lives have been trying to do. And this is what this is about.
Thank you so much, Professor Quan. Before we move to the second question, I want to give Jenn and Hakeem a chance to comment on contextualizing your work in history and also how your work is part of the resistance to white supremacy. If you could do that briefly, and then we'll move to the next question, and I'll turn it over to Jenn to moderate that.
Thank you all for having me. It's a real privilege to be in community with all of you this morning. So I see the work that I try to do is my scholarship is to give voice to an experience of Black people in this country, one that too often does not find its place in our top journals or at elite institutions that is often sidelined. Experiences that I know well, having grown up in rural South Carolina in an all-Black community, those are the experiences that I have tried in my academic scholarship and in my public work to give voice to. And we'll have an opportunity to talk more about that public work that I've been doing, but I see this work in a long tradition of scholars who have attempted to very clearly render and the humanity of Black people in this country. So that's the way that I see my work is fitting into this conversation.
Thank you, Hakeem. Jenn?
Thanks so much. So, you know, to begin, I'm a Black queer woman first. And so I see my work as situated in the arc of Black feminists and Black feminist elders and ancestors who preceded me in this discipline. I sit comfortably in that tradition, and also knowing that the work that I do at the nexus of racial threat, trauma, and policing, knowing that that has been predominantly seen as a conversation about reforms and whiteness. So my focus has really been about elevating and spotlighting those stories, those experiences, and the movement work of Black queer feminists, Fem of Center, young folks who have long been working in communities to answer the questions that we have just started asking. And so in this conversation and in this moment, I see myself as really trying to push the discipline on questions around policing, abolition, racial threat and trauma, and the kind of focus that we have on political psychology without talking necessarily to marginalized folks who are, I think, are the center of that conversation. So I would like to recenter those folks in those conversations.
Thank you so much, Dr. Jackson. Valeria, I told you we'd circle back to you. Would you like to have the last word before we move on to the next question here?
Thank you for the opportunity, Tony. I would like to just kind of pick up on this idea of a third reconstruction really briefly, and to mention William Barber. And some of you may have encountered him. He's moving across the country. He's now he started off in the North Carolina NAACP, and has now moved to a national campaign, a revival of the Poor People's Campaign. And that is the language that he uses is one of this third reconstruction of revival that perhaps predates the election of Barack Obama, but certainly builds on a kind of coalitional politics of young people and people of various backgrounds. I think in the way that Dr. Quan was talking about and some others, that there's a potential for significant change and reimagining that can come out of this moment, and that there's organization across the country, and perhaps even in something like the Poor People's Campaign that can work. And just also to add that one thing about this moment that I think is important is that as much as people like the last administration, the president who will never leave office apparently and cannot lose, that just like that, although they say that although they imagine that they can make America great again, that we actually can't turn back the clock. And so that will not happen, though they will certainly make us afraid or concerned that it could, as we saw, I think, on January 6th. And lastly, I wanted to mention that there are some things that we have a tendency to overlook, particularly in local politics. And I hope that perhaps someone in this room or others that we can work together to think about whatever happened to PTAs. My mother was the leader of the PTA, leader of labor organizations in the South that were really difficult to get started. But now PTAs are closely in the pocket of schools. And so it's very difficult to have a countering voice to the efforts of censorship and limitation in our schools. And so hopefully those are some areas that we can begin to look at too for our scholarship.
Thank you, Dr. Sinclair-Chapman. I'm gonna turn over the moderation duties now to Dr. Jackson for the next question. Thank all of you for your participation so far. And Dr. Jackson, go ahead.
Thank you so much, Tony. So I really want us to talk about now the stakes of public scholarship. I'm talking specifically, let's start with Dr. Jefferson and Dr. Quan, HQ. What are some of the stakes of public intellectualism right now in this moment, and how do we respond? Some of the kind of additional questions we have about this are thinking about the risks and opportunities of this type of work, and thinking about the state of your career that you're sitting in at this moment. So I know, Dr. Jefferson, you and I are right at the same stage, and Dr. Quan, you're in a different position. So if you can start, Dr. Jefferson, and help us to understand, like when you're thinking about your public intellectualism, what are you considering? What are the risks that you see with the work that you do?
Thank you for this question. I would not enjoy the job that I have were it not for the ability to communicate beyond the walls of a really exclusive and elite institution like Stanford. I appreciate the job that I have, but I have always thought of a role that I could play is to add clarity amidst a lot of noise. And we're in a moment where there are a lot of people who don't tell the truth. And I see my job, and I know you do as well, Jen, as telling the truth, as telling an uncomfortable truth to powerful people. And so that's why I do the public work that I do. There's a lot of noise. There's a lot of lack of clarity about the moment that we're in. And as I tell my students, I just don't want people to be able to say that they didn't understand what was happening. And so when I write at 538, or when I write an op-ed or in the other venues where I write publicly, it is an attempt to provide an explanation, an argument that helps us collectively make sense of the moment. And so at 538, a place known for its data journalism, for a long time, they did not deal honestly with questions of race. And more specifically, did not deal in any clear way with notions of white racism. And I like the freedom that I have to state it as plainly as I can in those pages. And so that I think is the power of our public scholarship. It is to add voice and clarity amidst a lot of noise. This second question about risk, it has never been lost on me that to do this work would come with some real risk. I don't think that I could imagine the sort of vile hatred that so many of us on this panel have received for our public work and our academic scholarship. I don't think that I recognize the amount of time that people are willing to spend writing handwritten postcards and finding your office email, your office box number. I don't even know what that is. And so I think I underestimated at some level how vile and how persistent white racism can be. But it's also not lost on me that I am at a conservative institution, that I am in a department known for its conservative elements. That is not lost on me. But I have decided that at the end of the day, I will let my department and my institution evaluate the quality of my scholarship and to put them in a position where if they wanted to exact some sort of retribution, they'd have to make a strong case for doing so. And so I do think that it heightens the burden on scholars like us, that we've got to play two very hard games, that we have a public audience that we want to speak to. But if you want to persist in this business, you also have to try and meet whatever standards these folks can set. And so that's the game that I've been trying to play. We'll see how it turns out. But I don't spend my days, frankly, worried about losing my job. The work that we do is far too important to me, and I care more about that than I do about being a political scientist, quite frankly.
Thank you, Dr. Jefferson. So Dr. Quan, I wanted to shift to you, and specifically in your comments earlier, you mentioned about the kind of threat in this moment, like how serious this moment is. And so if you can share from that perspective, thinking about the risks of being a public intellectual right now, being and actively fighting on behalf of Black lives or fighting against white racism and white supremacy, what that looks like in this moment.
Thank you. And I want to say that I entirely agree with Dr. Jefferson about the calculation that comes into play and also the not underestimating the fear that's involved and the risk that's involved in the work, but we do have an obligation. So in 2020, we with the pandemic and the mass protests, I actually was the editor in residence for Praxis, which is a social justice related blog. And we intentionally had two priorities. One is to show the way in which white supremacy operates in the US and in the world really, and the way in which it exacerbates certain vulnerabilities, particularly in the Black and Brown communities with respect to the pandemic. So we did that. This last year, 2021, I was a co-producer and co-host of a podcast called Equality Arizona Podcast. And we actually spent several episodes on censorship and this campaign of attacking particularly Black voices in the academy. I think it's important to, I mean, I've been doing radio for since the mid 1980s and doing documentary film since the mid 90s, early 90s. So I have a public, I don't just do traditional political science. I think that as my mentor, Elizabeth Robinson taught me many, many, many years ago, it's not enough to critique media, you have to do media. And so for those of us who do public scholarship, this is what we do, this is what living looks like. Cedric Robinson has always taught us that it's not enough to sort of engage with the terms of order. We have to actually overthrow it. We have to actually do something different, especially if we want to change the terms of living. So I became a target of David Horowitz's red baiting campaign in 2005, 2006, as part of that indoctrination thing. And I was an assistant professor at the time. I'm not going to minimize the way in which I had to change a couple projects because I find out that, for instance, my face along my picture along with David Horowitz's takedown of me shows up on the Tea Party, Arizona Tea Party website. And so therefore I couldn't do a stealth ethnography, which I had hoped to do. And their colleague who avoid me in the hallway, and graduate students who intentionally will let me do all the work for them, but did not want me to be on the committee because they want to have that association. But here's the thing, there are work that unless we do it, nobody else will. The work that bring visibility to the systematic violence and deracination that occur at the university and in life everywhere, right? So there are serious research that has to be done about heteropatriarchy, about settler colonialism, about white supremacy. That has to be done. And some of us, you know, yes, there's a lot more research now. There's still not enough. The field itself, political science, is still very white, very male, and still do very status quo stuff. And so for those of us, this is what living looks like. Yes, we are fearful, but I will also tell you that total stranger came up to me at academic conference and said, listen, I know you're an assistant professor. I know this is so not right that they go after you, but if you ever need any help, I'm here for you, total stranger. And honestly, I've never had to call them up on it, but it is really comforting to know that I'm always existing in solidarity. For every one of me, there are a lot more people who have been targeted every day and they have no resources that I have because I am an affiliate and I have an affiliation with the university and now I'm a tenured professor. So I wanna specifically speak to the untenured assistant professor and the lecturers and the adjunct people. It's not easy, but you don't have to do it alone. You do what you like because if they take that away from you, then they won. That's what censorship is about, right? So we got to do what we got to do, and we push back with the help of mass movement.
Absolutely. So I want to, you know, echo what Dr. Quan and Dr. Jefferson are both saying here from my own personal experiences, and I keep thinking about the quote, but some of us are brave, right? We don't have to do this work without fear, right? Doing this work in a brave and courageous way doesn't mean that we're not fearful, right? Last year, in my third year on the tenure track, was very fearful when people were commenting online, contacting my dean, demanding that the university remove me from my post. People were doxing me. There were students who were emailing me from their student email accounts. DPS was involved. The Federal Bureau of Investigation was involved. That's how deep this was. And so when you say Dr. Jefferson about how vile people can be, you know, folks leaving, you know, 10 minute long voice messages on my personal work phone messaging system, which I didn't even know my phone number at the time, you know. I'm still receiving handwritten letters from people that have to go through DPS before I'm even able to open my own mail, right? And so I think that, you know, we talk about the stakes, right? The stakes are incredibly high, and the more visible you are, right? The more visible you are and the more actively you fight on behalf of those groups that folks would prefer not matter, that folks would prefer be invisibilized, the more you are targeted. So I absolutely agree that this is necessary work. It's work that has to be done in this moment. I also just want to, I think, put a note in the fact that, you know, we are not a kind of new brand or new breed of scholar, right? The fact of the matter is that, you know, especially for Black scholars and public intellectuals, this is 100 years in that folks have been having to do public intellectualism on behalf of Black folks. And it's my argument, I actually believe fundamentally that doing work on behalf of Black folk, doing work on behalf of marginalized folk, we have to do public-facing work. Our work cannot exist only in the bounds and the walls, in the confines of our institutions. Because if, you know, my grandmother, my mother, the church folks can't read it, if they don't see themselves reflected, then what is the purpose of the work? And who's holding me accountable? Who am I accountable to? So I do think that there are questions here about accountability. There are questions here about how we situate ourselves with respect to the communities that we are working in advocacy for and on behalf of and in community with, right? And so I think that when we talk about risk, they're not just to the individual, but they're also to a communal form of silencing and censorship that folks are hoping that we will back away from. So I want to expand it now and ask Drs. Harris and Sinclair-Chapman if you would like to also kind of chime in on this question. I'm thinking specifically of Dr. Harris. You know, you've talked about your multiple books that are now being banned, and I imagine that it also has some implications for you in terms of public intellectualism. So if you'd like to share with that as well, I would love to hear more about that.
Sure. You know, I love when you brought up the concept, but some of us are brave, because the women who coined that phrase were members of the Combahee River Collective. And so when I got to graduate school, I decided I was going to write about the Combahee River Collective. And I was in grad school between 91 and 97. And I did interviews with the women who were involved in that organization. And at that time, no one had written about the Combahee River Collective. Kimberly Springer had written about the National Black Feminist Organization, but this work hadn't been published. I then went on the market to get a job, and I was hired in the political science department at McAllister College. And I went through the tenure process in political science, and I was granted tenure, but their sentiment was that my work wasn't politics. And I know a lot of people on this call have been told by traditional political science departments that their work is not political science. And when Tony opened up and said, okay, but political science was started in the 1880s by Klan sympathizers, it's not really an insult when you're told that your work isn't political science. My argument, however, was that my work was politics and that Black people do politics differently, right? So, I mean, this is like, you know, Melissa Harris, who then at the time was, you know, Lacewell, comes out with the concept that it's like Habermas talks about the public. You know, Black people have a Black public, and what we do in barbershops and what we do in churches and what we do when we are, you know, interacting with BET at the time, which is owned by Black people at the time, which was before Twitter, right? That is political acting. And so what makes it delicate when I try to mentor people is that my life ended up not being a cautionary tale, right? I ended up getting tenure. I ended up getting promoted to full professor. Not only after I was moved into an American Studies department after George Floyd was killed less than 10 miles from our campus, I amazingly was invited back to be affiliated with political science. And so this is their form of reparations, of course. But it does not always work out this way, that here it is 25 years after I get my PhD, people are talking about Combahee everywhere, right? It's on a podcast with the Smithsonian, not our Smithsonian, but our Smithsonian, but actually the American History Smithsonian is talking about identity politics today. And so, you know, it's risky, because you couldn't have convinced me in 97 that it was going to work out. And as we all know, sometimes it doesn't. But, you know, God takes care of babies and fools. And I think I was both. So that's what I'll say about that. And, you know, I can pass it over to my dear friend Valeria.
Valeria? Really brief comment before we wrap up.
Yeah, I just real quick, I wanted to just remind folks some of the elders that came before us, Ron Walters, William E. Nelson. When I was writing my dissertation, the question was, what does this have to do like that? What does this have to do with the liberation of Black people? And I think that that is an important refrain that we can come back to. And I'm struck by the fact that that generation of scholars was actually trying to get the first Black presidential candidate nominated for the Democratic Party, or to form a Black third party, or, I mean, these were activists. There was no difference between activism, or very little space between activism and scholarship. They didn't see a conflict there. And I think, just to echo Jen and others, Dr. Jackson and others, that we are part of a strong tradition. And it goes back very far to the very origins of NCOBPS as a revolutionary statement to the discipline, and as a claiming of space for scholars of color. So hopefully there's a little bit of time for other kinds of questions or comments, but thank you for this this wonderful panel and inspiring panel. And I'll say one last thing, that we do have to be multilingual. We have to be able to speak to the public and to those disciplines, because we want us to stay in it so we can change it from the inside out, like I was gonna say, like Alien, but you all understand what I'm talking about. So.
We are
so very much. Yes, go ahead, Dr. Affigne.
Yeah, thank you, Jen. We are scheduled to end in four minutes. even though we're virtual, a number of people who are participating in this panel need to be on the next panel cluster that starts at 12:30. So we can continue for just a few more minutes, but at a certain point, we're going to need to close this down. It's been a wonderful conversation, and I hope everyone participating on the panel has enjoyed being here, and I hope everyone in the audience has enjoyed and learned something from the dialogue. I want to add one comment, and it follows up with Valeria's. Part of the work that we do, and it's reflected in the very existence of NCOBPS, is institution building within the profession. When I attended my first APSA in 1988, I thought I had died and gone to old white man hell. It was just awful. And of course, I could have exercised exit. I certainly could not have exercised loyalty. My choice, and the choice of so many others, was to exercise my voice and begin building an infrastructure within the discipline, which has been part of the growth of our communities in the discipline, so that we now have hundreds and hundreds of Black and Latinx and Asian American and even increasingly Indigenous American political scientists doing the work. It's not just important because the books will be written and the articles will be published, but it's important because we have a community. It's important because when we go to conferences, we have people to share with, people to talk to, people to engage and dialogue with. So I absolutely agree that the work we do in the communities, our public-facing scholarship, our ability to speak in the vernacular of all of our different communities, our ability to speak to the issues and concerns of the people, all of those are important. But it's also important that we recognize the great power and the great responsibility that we have to build that infrastructure of supportive communities within the discipline, so that we're not the last generation of scholars who do the work that we do. This has to continue growing and growing and growing, because the work, as others have said, is just so terribly important that our individual careers are much less important than what we build for one another and the community of scholars that we help to foster. So we have just a couple more minutes. I want to open it up to the rest of our panelists. I'm sorry, we're not going to have time for questions and answers, although I see a lot of people have been engaging in the chat, and that's a good way to reach us as well. So anyone else on the panel? HQ, Jen, Hakeem, anyone? Go ahead, HQ.
I just want to share that lately I've been thinking about Audre Lorde a lot. And one of the things that she reminded us is that poetry is not a luxury, which means for us, especially those of us who are scholar activists, we do what we do because this is what living looks like. So we're still teaching and doing the things that those people don't want us to do. But if we don't, unless we write and teach and think what we like, as Stephen Biko understood, we have to fight back when we're not allowed to do so, because what lies ahead is a frightful prospect. But what lies ahead, if we do push forward, is also terribly exciting. So that's what I would say. And thank you so much for letting me be part of this conversation.
All right, I want to thank President Willoughby Herard for her passion and her hard work. She follows in a long line of extremely hardworking NCOBPS presidents. I am continually amazed by the amount of effort and dedication that we see at the top of this organization. And in particular, I want to thank her in this pandemic madness that we've been living through for doing the work and keeping the faith, and for inspiring all of us on this panel to be here today and to engage in this discussion. So with that, I want to close off this session and thank all of you for coming and wish you the very best in the next couple of days at NCOBPS. And I will see you all in person next year.
Thank you all for being here.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Excellent panel. Bye-bye.
Go read Duchess' work.
Goodbye, everybody.